I'm Hendrik Jan Thomassen. I work for AT Computing in Nijmegen. And no, I think I will manage. Am I understandable at the last row of the audience? Okay. I was invited to present this talk. I presented it last year at the TIDOS, but that was during the social event. And I got a phone call from Jean-Paul, and he wanted me to give it as a keynote for the entire audience this time. Also, however, last year's social event was better populated than this lecture here. But anyhow, what I would like to talk about is how the world looked like 45 years ago when UNIX was designed by Ken Thompson and Dennis Ritchie. And I want to put an emphasis on details that still are present in modern Linux to show you how Linus Torvalds, who is a giant in his own right, started by standing on the shoulder of other giants, namely Ken Thompson and Dennis Ritchie. And I have to turn this one on, right? This is a rather well-known picture. It is from 1972. Standing is Dennis Ritchie, sitting is Ken Thompson, and in the background is the PDP 1145 made by Digital Equipment, on which they gave the UNIX system the final shape. There were a few predecessor machines. UNIX design started in 1969, so that's about 3 years earlier than this one. When this picture was taken in 1972, the machine was brand new. The model was introduced by Digital Equipment just a few months before, and the manufacturer made a pre-production batch of 10 machines, and this is one of them. Picture is taken in a laboratory of AT&T, a Bell Labs in Murray Hill, which is in New Jersey, very close to New York City. And the main computer in this laboratory was a General Electric. And General Electric had an operating system called GCOS, but they wanted a new operating system, and together with MIT and people from Bell Labs, the design of a successor operating system for this General Electric computer was started. And this system became already famous from the publications and from the specifications. The name of the system was Multics, M-U-L-T-I-C-S. For political reasons, the Bell Labs crew was withdrawn from the project and did not immediately get a new project assigned, so they started to build a hobby project for their own to support their own work, which is program development. So they wanted to create a program development environment. This system got as a pun name the name UNIX because it was inspired by this Multics system. But it was, of course, much smaller, and Brian Kernighan, who was also one of the team members, coined the name UNIX, initially spelled with U-N-I-C-S, but later converted to U-N-I-X, giving the familiar extension IX, which, of course, still lives today in Linux. Well, that's not IX, but UX, but anyhow. But what kind of a machine do we have here? This machine is small in an absurd way. If you compare it to modern-day machines, then you could, for instance, look at Moore's Law. Moore's Law states that every 1.5 years, the component density on chips doubles. And there is a derivative of Moore's Law, coined by one of the Intel directors, which then says the result of this is that the speed of a machine doubles almost every 2 years, speed being dependent on the distance between the components and also on faster switching times and so on. If you apply that Moore's Law to this machine, which is now, let me say, 45 years ago, then you first divide it by 1.5, so 45 divided by 1.5 is 30, and then you calculate 2 to the power 30, because, well, that's the doubling in speed every time, and then you get to 1 billion. So a modern-day machine is about 1 billion times faster than this machine was. And a billion times, how much is that? Well, I always try to visualize these kind of numbers when I'm teaching about them. And a billion times, if you compare 1 second to 30 years. So that's incredible. This machine took 30 years to do what a modern machine does in 1 second. So you can understand how primitive the environment was where these people designed their genial system. It is sometimes said that the real good designs can be identified by seeing that many years later they survived an upscaling of many, many more times than the original designers had envisioned. We see that from the internet, but you can also see that from the design of the Unix machine, right? Well, as I said, this machine was one out of a pre-production batch of 10. Let me see. When I studied at the University of Nijmegen, well, informatics studies didn't exist yet, so I was a mathematics student. Then the computer science studies appeared on the horizon, and the faculty in Nijmegen where I studied wanted to prepare for the startup of an IT studies. And there was not too much computer knowledge around, so they imported an American professor to bring computer science colleges to Nijmegen University. And this American professor had relationships within digital equipment, and he also bought one of these machines, and that was installed in Nijmegen. In those days, Unix was not hardware independent. You actually needed this type of hardware in order to be able to run a Unix system. Well, as I said, I was a student. I was almost at the end of my studies, and I got good degrees from the course of this American professor. So the faculty director pulled me out of the stream and said, well, we need local knowledge. And they started to invest in me. They offered me a job after I finished my studies. And as part of this offer, they sent me to the American group of this American professor, where I stayed a couple of months. And this American professor called friends and relatives in the environment and said, well, I have this young Dutch guy and he is studying, and he wants to see a bit more of the world. And can you please entertain him one day and show him what's going on in your lab? And one of the people he called are these two people here, and he sent me over to this place. So in June 1974, I met Ken Thomassen and Dennis Ritchie at this place here, and I've seen this machine exactly the way it is shown on this picture here. They showed me around what this machine could do under the Unix operating system, and I was bloody impressed. And as I said, we luckily had exactly the same hardware in Nijmegen, so I asked him whether I could get a copy, and the answer is yes, and I asked how much does it cost, and he said nothing. So from a university standpoint, that was a good deal, right? We used the operating system that the manufacturer sold with this machine, and it was called DOS. In those days, every manufacturer was very proud that they had left the paper tape-based operating systems behind them and that they could deliver a disk-based operating system. So DOS is not the name of a system of Microsoft. DOS was a generic name. Any operating system that was disk-based was called a DOS. So this machine had digital equipment DOS. And well, later on we saw other companies like MS-DOS and so on. But there is still a lot of paper tape going around on this picture here. For instance, not what I wanted. This here is a paper tape unit. And, I can give you an impression on how just before these people designed this operating system, a machine of this caliber was being operated. For instance, if you had written a little program in any programming language, like, PL1, you first typed your source code on a little paper tape. There's a little paper tape puncher on the side of this unit here. So you typed your source code on a paper tape. Then you put in the tape with the first pass of the compiler, and by toggling on the switches here, you could start this, and the tape was read in. Then you inserted the paper tape with your source code, and you again fiddled with the switches, so that was read in, and the punch spit out a paper tape with the intermediate code that the first pass of the compiler had produced. So then you inserted the tape with the second pass of the compiler. You inserted the tape that you just had received after running the first pass of the compiler, and then the end result of the compilation came out on paper tape. Then you inserted the tape with the linker, then you inserted the tape that you just received from the second pass of the compiler, you again fiddled with the switches, and then came out the paper tape with the executable. So that was the general way of operating a machine of this size in those days. So when these people, and also the manufacturer, came up with a disk-based operating system, this was bloody new and a huge leap forward in the way you could use these machines. A little bit more about this hardware. It was a 16-bit CPU design. It could hold a quarter of a megabyte of memory, but nobody could afford that because a quarter of a megabyte of memory, would fill a full cabinet. So we at the university typically had 64K, and then we bought a little bit extra, and we bought a little bit extra. In general, the idea was that the budget of our university department, every year we asked for, dear Santa, could we get another 8K of memory for our department computer? Yeah? 8K, right? Of course, there was no room to run a TCP/IP stack, so that's out of the question. This machine had a very typical architecture. It had a so-called split IND space. So if you have an executing program, then the instructions and the data are in two separate address spaces. So 64K for the instructions was the maximum, 64K for the corresponding data was the maximum. So in total, you could have 128K programs. The machine had twice as much memory, so the deal was the kernel takes half of it, 64K data, 64 instructions, and the other 64K data and 64 instruction space was meant for the application that was running at this moment. Maybe you know that if you read from the keyboard, then for instance using the standard C library stuff, then the terminal driver collects an entire line of keystrokes until you hit the enter key, and then the terminal driver releases this line and gives it to the reading program, right? That's also a big surprise if I teach a course about the C programming language. Yeah, you let students write a little program that reads from the keyboard, and when they start the program, they start typing, and nothing happens, and not until they hit the enter key, then the program starts prrrr and consumes all the characters that you wrote. This design that the terminal driver collects all the keystrokes comes from the shortage of memory that this computer has. For instance, 10 years later, 12 years later than this picture was taken, the VI editor was designed. So imagine, VI was a big program according to the standards of those days. And now assume that you have two VIs running in this machine, right? Kernel takes half the memory, the other half is for the application program. But two VIs don't fit together, so one must be swapped out, the other one must be swapped in. But VI introduced the C break mode in the terminal driver, which means that the application can ask the terminal driver to release a character immediately after the key was hit. Yeah, it's not the same as raw mode. Linux people always mix C break mode and raw mode in the terminal driver, but I'm talking about C break mode here because, of course, when you are using VI, you can't tell to the user that when you hit an arrow key, then you must hit an enter after that, because otherwise the terminal driver doesn't release your keystroke, right? Which meant in this computer here that putting the terminal driver in C break mode means one keystroke from one of the VI users, yeah, swapping out the current VI, swapping in the other VI, then have the reaction, yeah, then the other person hits one of his keys, so the other VI is swapped out, his VI is swapped in, and you can imagine that two VI sessions are more than this machine can bear. Incredible, isn't it? But how much would such a machine cost? I estimate in this configuration that on the Dutch market this would have cost 300,000 to 400,000 guilders. And for this amount of money you could buy a freestanding house. Yeah? What else do we have? The next picture here is taken from a slightly different angle, and what you see here is the CPU console, and this here is a separate computer that is connected to it, and the only purpose of this computer is to control this display here. So this is the display controller computer. I think this is a PDP 1120 for those of you who are a bit familiar with these numbers, but this is the main console of the 1145. It was invisible here in this picture here, hidden behind, you see a little corner here. But speaking about this display processor, this is where Ken Thompson designed his famous Moonlander program on. As you know, display has phosphor. Phosphor extinguishes, so you have to refresh the image 24 times per second or whatever. But that requires memory, and memory was bloody expensive, as I just told you, yes. So what typically was used in this kind of configurations was a disk, which is this one here. We had one of those in Nijmegen as well. I still remember that we paid 60,000 guilders for it, and it held a quarter of a megabyte of space. But it was not really a disk. It was a drum derivative, which means it did not have a moving arm, but it had a row of heads above every track. So every track had its own head. So what you did is your moving image was split into frames. You put every frame on one of the tracks of this disk. There was hardware support that helped pump the data from one track into this computer, which then displayed it onto the screen. And the moving of the picture was established by having this disk switch from track to track to track to track. And when you had occupied all the tracks, then there were no moving frames anymore, so the films were typically rather short, as you can imagine. What else do we have here? Magnetic tapes. Very impressive, 2400 foot reels. You probably have seen these on television series and so on. But give you an impression on how much this tape would hold. Many years later, at Nijmegen University, we bought our first 70 megabyte disk. Wow, 70 megabyte disk. It had the size of a washing machine. I had to order three-phase power on the computer room, and that was needed for a 70 megabyte disk. But as part of the purchase, I tried to hide the purchase of a little cart, a little push car. The purchase department of the university already knew my bag of tricks, so it didn't work. But why did I want a push car when I buy a 70 megabyte disk? Well, I needed the push car for the pile of tapes that was required to back up this 70 megabyte disk. So remember, they look very impressive, but you need a pile about this size to fit the content of a 70 megabyte disk. Well, what else do we have? Paper tape. I already spoke about paper tapes. I don't know whether the younger people in the audience have ever seen a paper tape. This is paper tape, right? It holds 400 bytes per meter. And yesterday I was again thinking about visualize these kind of numbers. Now assume that you have a 64 gigabyte USB stick. If you convert these data onto paper tape, then it would almost be fitting around the world. Yeah, 64 gigabyte of paper tape. You can circle the globe with that. Well, anyhow. One of the nicest things to look here is this disk here. This was the main operational disk. It was a cassette drive, 14-inch platters. It held 2.5 megabytes. And when I saw this machine, I asked Ken, I see you have two of these drives, And that's a little bit of a problem because we in Nijmegen only have one of these drives, and can we then still run Unix? And he said, yeah, of course you can run Unix. You need one drive for the system, remind you, 2.5 megabytes. And the other drive is only needed if you want to keep all the source code online. All source code, kernel, utilities, everything fitted on a 2.5 megabyte disk drive, right? Well, they fixed that nowadays. 2.5 megabytes wouldn't even hold your average JPEG picture. Right, what else do we have? Yeah, the working console. 110 baud. So it produces 10 characters a second. And the keys really require a hard hit. So if you had been working a full day, then you really felt the etching in your knuckles. And that's the reason why the Unix command repertoire has these very short names, like RM and LS and CP and MV and so. You know, if you can save one typing keystroke per command, that really helps. What else do I have? Yeah, small memory. I remember that for many years to come, the newer releases of the Unix kernel came with an instructions to install, and these instructions said, well, we have this new facility in the kernel, and you can enable or disable it, but if you enable it, it will cost you 40 bytes. And then we have this new feature, and if you enable it, then it costs you 120 bytes. And we have this new feature, and if you enable it, it costs you, well, so many bytes. And, of course, the rule of the game was to configure your kernel such that you had everything that you needed, and you filled your available memory space up to the last byte. We spent quite a lot of time in this kind of kernel tuning. Yeah. This disk, 4872 sectors of 0.5 kilobyte each. And what we typically did is you did an MKFS for 4,000 sectors, so you had 872 available at the end. And that was used as a swapping space. And for many, many years, commands like swap on and enabling the swapping configuration had the possibility to start swapping beyond the start of a partition, because the first part, so many sectors were then used for the file system, and beyond that you had free space that was used for swapping. I just checked whether the modern Linux still supports it, but they probably have removed it because I couldn't see it anymore. Another nice anecdote. This machine, of course, needs a swapping algorithm. And I remember that we had a conference somewhere in Florence, and Ken Thomassen was one of the speakers. He's a very bad speaker, but in the evening, all the foreigners were in the same hotel, and in the evening, it really started to become nice because, well, we had this sitting in the bar, Ken Thomassen in the middle, everybody around in circles on the ground. And, questions were being asked, and I remember one of the people said to Ken, well, you have this swapping algorithm in the kernel, but it is so ugly. Why didn't you put a bit more effort in this kernel swapping algorithm? And Ken said, well, my machine doesn't swap, so why would I put effort in it? And he continued, he said, well, of course you need a swapping algorithm, because if too many pages are being claimed and the machine grinds to a halt, that's not elegant, so you need a swapping algorithm, but we don't want our machine to swap. What they had done in Bell Labs, and that's what he explained to us, is you have these little lights on the front console, yeah? And they had, you could control them under software, and they had soldered a couple of wires on one of the lamps here, and attached them to a relay on top of the cabinet. And he said, when my swapping algorithm gets activated, then we turn on the little lamp, and the little lamp turns on the relay on the top of the cabinet, and that turns up on a big lamp. And he said, we told our secretary that when she walks along the computer room and she sees that the lamp is on, she should order more memory. So, I asked them for a copy. I got a copy. Ken Thomassen himself prepared one of these disk cartridges and sent it over to Nijmegen, and that's how we started to use our first Unix, which was in the fall of 1974. When I was there, I asked him whether he could give me some references, because Unix was new for me. Yeah, I was I came there by accident, and they introduced me to the system, and I had never heard of UNIX before. So I asked him, I have to convince my faculty director, can you please tell me who else in the world is using the UNIX system? All licenses were done by the librarian in this laboratory here, so Ken brought me to the librarian, and they looked up who had the UNIX license, and there was one person in Europe, which was Professor George Colouris from Queen Mary College in London. They wrote my name as the second one on the list as the European. I was naive. I asked, don't you have somebody closer than London, closer to Nijmegen than London? He said, no, the second one closest is in Tel Aviv. I must admit, though, that when we got our cartridge, then a professor from Louvain-la-Neuve in Belgium was a little bit earlier. So I was the first one in the Netherlands, but not the first one in the Benelux. Some Belgian university site bypassed me and had their Unix up before I had up mine. What else do we have? This is the computer that we had in Nijmegen. When the university wanted to junk it, they donated it to me. And I still have it in one of the lecture rooms of my company as a conversation piece. In its heydays, this was an 11-cabinet machine, but of course I couldn't take all 11 cabinets. So I collected the most interesting parts in here. This is the back panel of this controller, the controller that controls these two drives. You see, this is one drive similar that Ken Thomassen had. This one is the same compatibility, but a few years younger. Well, we could buy a second disk in Nijmegen eventually and hold the source code online as well. One of these units costed 20,000 guilders. I still remember that one. Yeah. The little tape unit, the front console again. This one is full of memory, the bottom half of this cabinet. Here the teletype, again 110 baud, paper tape, punch paper tape reader next to it. See, this is where the little paper confetti drops in. That's a question that gets asked all the time. No, it doesn't. But I have been a system administrator for this machine for almost 13 years. And so I pretty well know that the mean time between failure was about 1.5 years. It does not have a computer on a chip, right? Computer, CPU on a chip didn't exist yet. So if you look at the CPU consists of electronic boards about this size here. Yeah, and then a pile about this thick. And every 1.5 years, one of these boards would somehow blow. Then the maintenance man from Digital Equipment would come in, and he had his box full of replacement boards. Board swapping was done until the machine worked again. He took the defective board with him to repair, and we got the bill of 10,000 guilders for the exchange of one of these boards. So 1.5 year costs 10,000 guilders then. Yeah. Another point is this machine required half a day of maintenance every 6 weeks. So the technician from Digital Equipment would come in, he would spend half a day maintaining this machine, which meant checking all the power supplies, checking all the fans. In these two cabinets here, in total we have 35 fans. Yeah. Disk pack had to be aligned. You needed special alignment track cassettes, cartridges to do the job. Well, I don't have one. So that's the reason I can't get this machine up and running again. However, near Nijmegen is a hobby person, Geert Rolf, and he has a computer museum called Te Huis voor Bejaarde Computers. You can Google for it. And he has one of these still up and running. So if you really want to see one of those, contact Geert Rolf, Te Huis voor Bejaarde Computers in Winsen bij Nijmegen. And tell him that you really would love to see one of these still in running order. Yeah? And the rest of his museum is worth visiting as well. He usually opens at the Open Museum Dagen. So. What else? Yeah, so this was... now I have copied a couple of pages from a very early Unix manual. I have the original one with me here. You are welcome to look at it later on during the day. This is Unix 5th edition. This is the manual from 1973. And this is the table of contents from this manual here. And, well, look at how familiar these names are. AR, to make a library, still exists. AS, well, it still exists hidden under the CC command. Cut, CC is already there. The C debugger, change directory, they shortened this name now to CD. Change mode is there, change own is there, compare is there. This one, yeah, common, yeah, still exists, yeah. Copy is still there. Cross-reference listing is, I don't think so, that was kind of a half compiler to make a cross-reference listing from your source code. I think that would in modern days be done by an extra flag to the CC command or whatever, if it still is possible. Well, command date, command DB, command DC, command DD, they all exist. By the way, you know where the DD command, convert and copy, gets its name from? Why it was called DD? No. Well, yeah, according to good habits, it would have been called CC, but CC was already occupied here. So that's why they shifted all the characters one step forward in the alphabet. If you ever come to a UNIX trivia quiz, this will be a sure question. Yeah. So, well, I told you, you'll learn very useful things from me during this lecture. This is a nice one. Delete interactively. I'll have a separate copy of this page later on in the pile. But well. Maybe just one or two of this list are not present in modern day Linux. See? So, chapter one, right? F, yeah, next page. Grep was there already, regular expressions were there already. The shell didn't have programming language constructs, so F was a separate command. Yeah? LD is still there, LN is still there, although it only made hard links. Soft links were invented later by the Berkeley people, so this is for hard links only. This is still there, this is still there, this is still there. Manual command was already there. Same format that we still have for manual pages. Yeah, message still there, make there still there, move still there. EQN still there. Nice command still there. NM still there, NoHub still there. This is called GROV in modern terminology, but well, it's the successor. OD, OPR is not here anymore. It's offline print. It probably meant that the job was sent to another computer and printed there. Print floating point exception is not there anymore. Has to do with the idiosyncrasies of the hardware of the CPU design. If you had an arithmetic overflow in the integer calculating, the CPU would just produce a wrong result. But if you had an arithmetic exception in a floating point calculation, then the CPU would trap and the operating system would trap it, and a signal would be sent to the process that did the violating stuff. So that's why there is still, if you look at the signal list in a modern Linux system, there is still a SIG FPE, SIG floating point exception, which is now...
Huh? It also traps integer divisions by zero.
At this moment, yes, but not on this hardware. So that's why it's called SIG FPE, because it, in the old days, only worked for floating point exceptions, since integer exceptions did not produce any reaction in the hardware except for a wrong result. Yeah. Well, that's the start page. I'm not going to go through all them, but see, here we are at the end of the alphabet. So this was the command repertoire of Unix in the early 70s. Yeah? Compare this to a modern Linux system, which has almost 4,500 commands in chapter one. Then you see that it was... The system expanded a bit over the last few decades. But the nice thing is that so many of these commands that were invented at the very beginning are still present in a modern Linux system. It's yeah, incredible. Here we have a page of one of the commands. That's DSW. And it says the name DSW is a carryover from the ancient past. Its etymology is amusing. So almost nobody knows the etymology. This is what in modern systems we have RM with the minus I flag. So the interactive remove, right? RM minus I star. then you get a whole list of file names, and every file name is printed on your console, and then you type yes or no in order to get the remove done or just not done. But this is delete from switches. That's where the abbreviation comes from. So you started this command, you also gave it a list of file names, and then the file names would be printed one after one, and then you had to toggle the switches on the front console in order to answer the question yes, yes or no. So it's delete from switches and not delete by typing typing yes and no. Yeah, this is the find command. It's very small print. I really did this because I want to zoom in on the next page here. But you see, print is already pretty powerful. All the things that are on this list here are still present in... Sorry, did I say print? Find, it's find, yeah. All the things that are listed here are still present in a modern-day find. But the interesting thing, who of you uses the find command? C. Very powerful command, but it has, so to speak, a baroque user interface, right? Okay. Look at what this says here. Yeah, they didn't change the syntax yet. On Linux, the manual page of the find command is now 1,500 lines. Yeah, in these days, you saw the previous page and you saw this page. That's all there is. So they expanded this command a little bit as well. But all the basics are still there, right? Here we come to the chapter 2, the system call chapter. And once again, if you're a bit familiar with the modern collection of system calls, much larger than this one is, of course, but almost everything that is in the list here is still present. Yeah, fork, we have exec, dup. This one doesn't exist anymore, read console switches, right? Create still there, close, change own, stuff is all there, right? There is a nice story connected to the name of the CREAT system call. You know what it does, yeah? It is like opening a file, but if the file exists, it empties it and creates a new one. That's what the shell uses when you have a single greater sign in your command line, yeah? And especially affect what happens when there is already a file present that has the name that you use after the greater sign in your command line. Many, many, many years after this, Ken Thompson and Dennis Ritchie received the Turing Award. And the Turing Award is in computer science the equivalent of the Nobel Prize. And after the prize was awarded, Ken Thompson got an interview from a reporter from the communications of the ACM. And this lady asked him the typical question that you ask to an old man and you really don't know what you have to ask. He said, "Mr. Thompson, you look back on a splendid career. You have been world champion computer chess with your program Belle. You invented the UNIX operating system, which made you bloody famous. You contributed to the C programming language together with Dennis Ritchie. If you now look back on this career and think what you would have done different if you couldn't do all over again." Well, Ken Thompson scratched his bald head and thought long and deep and said, in Unix terminology, I would write create with an E at the end. So looking back on his career, this is his major mistake, that there is a missing E here at the end, right? Yeah, this is also a very interesting picture. This is a patent, an extract from official patent documentation. And as you may see here, Ritchie, Dennis M., Bell Telephone Laboratories. Nowadays, software patents are bad. But in those days, Dennis Ritchie had a software patent. And we thought, cool, a software patent. This really must be an original idea. And what was patented was the set UID mechanism. Yeah? And But the idea was, in those days, software patents didn't exist yet, so the lawyers at Bell Laboratories had to mimic the SetUID invention, which is a pure software invention. They had to mimic it as a hardware design. And what you actually see here is computer, file control, login sequence, all kinds of file accesses. Here you have stored data, user ID, owner ID, SetUID bit, and so on and so on. And then after a lot of fiddling around with all these AND gates and NAND gates, it says access denied, see here. And so that's how they explain the SetUID mechanism to non-software people. Believe me, explaining it to software people is a lot easier. But we thought this was cool. UNIX really is something new, and there is even a patent attached to it. Wow. Yeah. Now you can probably read what it says here, right? I enlarged the print a little bit. Next. This is UNIX News. That was the newsletter of the UNIX user group. But the UNIX user group in the United States, which is called UsenIX nowadays, in those days was, of course, very small. It was organized by a professor from one of the universities around New York. And what he actually did is he sent out this this magazine to everybody who had the license. So you became automatically a member of the worldwide UNIX user group. And this is the first copy that I received. And see here, circulation 49. So that was the worldwide number of UNIX licenses in those days. This one here, July 75. So that's already 1 year after we got our UNIX, and it says new system available, the 6th edition is now available. See? You can get it on 800 BPI tape, those are, but you have to pay a $150 nuisance fee. This is the librarian in Murray Hill, the laboratory where Ken and Dennis worked. The tape contains a single file which extracts to 3 arcade packs or equivalent, the system code except for user source. Then another pack with user source, and then another pack with documentation in machine-readable form, right? So that's 3 times 2.5 megabytes. So that's a 7.5 megabyte distribution for your new version of UNIX. Now, the goodies. Yeah? Huge files, up to 16 megabytes, are now supported. Yeah? A preprocessor for structured Fortran. Fortran was really popular in those days. The DC command was introduced here. Much improved comments embedded in the system source. I'll come back to that in a couple of slides later here. Yeah? And the graceful dead on running out of resources and other crashes. Well, this machine had almost no resources at all, so graceful dead was really needed. It really happened. Yeah. So this is the way that the UNIX community communicated in those early days. Internet, of course, didn't exist. Glossy magazines about UNIX didn't exist. Those of you who still remember how stenciling went, this was gestenceld de blaadjes, yeah, and well, it was sent out to everybody who had a UNIX license in those days. Well, the source code was online, but the source code did not have too many comments on board. Actually, it only had the kernel source only had one comment line on board, a very famous one. But then there was John Lyons. John Lyons was a professor at the University of New South Wales in Australia. And he published a commented kernel source and a separate booklet that had exegesis, that had explanation of all these lines. You see he added line numbers. And this really was an eye-opener. This enabled less intelligent people like me to understand what was going on in the kernel code. Because from just reading the kernel source, well, it was not easy to understand. By the way, the Wikipedia page of the Lyons books says, let me quote, many pioneers of UNIX and open source had a treasured multi-generation copy of the Lyons book. It had more or less the reputation that it was the most copied text in the world. But 2 originals. Yeah, the kernel source and the comments, and you're welcome to talk to me later on the day and have a look on how it looked like. John Lyons published the availability of these books in one of these newsletters, and I immediately ordered a box of 20. John Lyon said, I asked the AT&T lawyers for permission, and I got permission, so I'm free to publish this stuff. But somehow the lawyers had been asleep, and 1 month later they had woken up. So in the next newsletter, John Lyon put up a little article that says, I'm sorry guys, but the lawyers of AT&T contacted me again and forbid the further distribution of the booklet. And luckily, I had my pile of 20 copies, of which this one of the remaining ones. And then it was forbidden to distribute it. If you had an AT&T license, source license, you could order a copy of the books from AT&T. But AT&T had a huge legal contract that forbid you to quote about it. You couldn't even show one of the source lines in courses or whatever. And this was the moment that Andy Tannenbaum decided that, one, it is a beautiful design to teach my students. Second, AT&T forbids quoting just a single source line from this source. So Andy Tannenbaum started to write a re-implementation of at least the system call interface of this kernel. He called it Minix. And as we all know, Linus Torvalds started his Linux creation by taking Minix from Andy Tannenbaum. So this is more or less in the pre-traject of how Linux came into existence. The famous programming line, the famous comment line that is in this source code is shown here, and that's this one here. This is Dennis Ritchie. It is a very typical place. What happens at this point here is one process has done a system call and will be scheduled out. Another process takes over, but as you may or may not know, if the process is inside kernel space, it has its own stack page. But when you do a process switch, you have to switch the stack space. So the running thread of execution, yeah, the stack page is pulled out under one, and a new stack page is put under this running execution thread, and then all of a sudden it is another process, right? That's what happens here in this code. If you look careful, see what happens here. Equal sign ampersand. In modern C, the ampersand would be on the other side of the equal sign. See, but this is pre-Kernighan and Ritchie C. Speaking about Kernighan and Ritchie C, maybe if we look back here, what you see, for instance, that is that no, there are no good examples from what I want to tell here. Sorry, no. When this is all in the years of 16-bit CPU designs, but in the late 70s, the 32-bit CPUs came forward. And here we have an announcement of the University of Wollongong in Australia, and they announced that they had converted UNIX to run on a 32-bit computer. The manufacturer brand was Perkin Elmer. They were a computer manufacturer in those days. Basically, they are a company that specializes in optics. Perkin Elmer still exists. They are the ones that blew the mirror of the Hubble telescope, right? That was also a product of Perkin Elmer. Anyhow, the University of Wollongong converted UNIX to 32-bit, and here they announced the availability. It is 1980, see? So then the conversion from 62-bit implementations to 32-bit implementations started. At about the same time, the Bell Labs people were also working on this conversion. They bought a VEX computer, which was also new on the market. And the Bell Labs people discovered that quite a lot of details in the design of the C language were 16-bit dependent. And they cleaned up the language in order to support the port to 32-bit designs. And actually, Kernighan and Ritchie C is the definition of the C language, how it came out of this process. So it is the C language after the cleanup when the kernel was converted from 16-bit to 32-bits. But that was not done here at Wollongong. They were the first. Bell Labs, with their own distribution, were the second one in time. What else do I have? Yeah. AT&T had a telephone monopoly in the States, and governments don't like monopolists, so AT&T was under heavy scrutiny, and they were forbidden to enter other markets than the telephone market because, well, in the telephone market they made too much money too easily. So they could not sell UNIX. They had this beautiful product, a lot of people wanted it, and they couldn't sell it. But somehow there was a businessman, a genial businessman from whom we have heard a lot later, who managed to get a reseller contract for UNIX. And believe me or believe me not, this was Bill Gates. Bill Gates was in his early days the first commercial UNIX seller. They called their product Xenix. They called their product Xenix. And look here, Microsoft is committed to supporting the Xenix system as an environment for program development that will be identical on all popular 16-bit microprocessors. Different CU, control units, as well as different hardware boards will be supported, blah, blah, blah. Yeah, and, well, yeah. Zilog Z8000, Motorola M68000, Intel 8086, and of course the DEC PDP-11. I once saw one of these PDP-11 versions, and it was bug-for-bug compatible with the PDP-11 version that that Bell Laboratories delivered. So, yeah. Later on, Bill Gates discovered that he could make more money in different areas of the computer field, but he was the first UNIX seller. So it's kind of strange that now Microsoft is again entering the UNIX field by supporting Linux under their Azure cloud system. Yeah, so they are back from the fact that that they already have been there in the UNIX world. What is this? This is, if I recall well, 1983. This was the very first book that was published about UNIX. I still have a copy with me. 500 pages, yeah, it says here, 1983. Here is one of the pages in the book, and it is a table that lists application programs for the UNIX operating system. Continued, so this is page number 2, but that's all there is. So 1983, yeah, you look around on the market and see what applications programs are commercially available for use under UNIX, and then you can have a list of, you get a list of 2 pages. See? Times have changed. What is funny here is that you see a heavy IBM influence here. Yeah. IS-1 was an IBM implementation of UNIX on mainframes. Yeah. The little slash that is typical for IBM naming format. Remember that one? Yeah. We had IS-1 and we had OS-2. Remember those two? Yeah, so we made a pun of it. We said this slash is a division line, so OS2 is just half an operating system and this is an entire operating system. Yeah. Well, this is the last slide of my lecture, and this is Eindhoven. Yeah, the PMDS system. Picture is from around 1984, 1985. And, well, UNIX was not well known outside the university circles, but some manager here in Eindhoven said to the people who built this machine that their next generation was supposed to run under UNIX. This is a logic analyzer and in circuit emulator, so you use this to debug micro CPU boards. Yeah, you can. This machine helps you to step through your software when you are debugging software that will be implemented into a hardware board. And well, some manager in Eindhoven said to the people who built this thing that the next generation had to be based on UNIX, and the people who had to do the job looked around and said, UNIX, who knows about UNIX? Some person in Philips Eindhoven here knew me, still working at Nijmegen University. I had devised a course for internal use within the university, and these people came to us and said, can you please present the course to us? And we are willing to pay for it. So within the university, I started to teach courses to external parties. And, well, as you may or may not know, I still do teach courses for external parties. That's the main line of my company, AT Computing. And that's the end of the talk. Any questions?
What's AT standing for?
Oh, I started the company with a colleague also from the university. His name was Ger Austin, and my name is Thomassen, so that's the A and the T. And we saw, gee, we have this at sign on the keyboard that nobody ever uses and nobody knows what it's good for, and we can use that as the company logo. I tell you a nice story. We ordered letter paper and business cards and the whole stuff. And in those days, you had to acknowledge the fact that UNIX was a trademark from AT&T. So at the foot of business cards and papers and so on, if the word UNIX was on it, you had to say UNIX is a registered trademark of AT&T Bell Laboratories. And our printer looked at it. We had approved the print copies and so on, but at the very last moment our printer looked at it and said, that's wrong, the company is not called AT&T, the company is called AT. So we got our whole first initial batch of business cards, letterhead and so on, and it said, UNIX is a trademark of AT. In those days, AT&T had lawyers all over the world watching the use of their trademark. There was a lawyer company in Delft who kept an eye on the Dutch market. So we are very afraid that this would ever get into the wild. So we threw everything in the shredder and asked the printer to print a new badge. While at the university, this colleague, Ger Ooster, and myself wrote the first book about UNIX in Dutch language. And it was used at HBO instellingen, MBO instellingen, and so on. And as usual, people didn't refer to the book by the title, but referred by the authors. So yeah, that's the book by Austin and Thomassen. And from the book by Austin and Thomassen, we founded the company of Austin and Thomassen. That's how.
Cool, thanks.